Okay. Hi everyone. Welcome to Become and Know It All. I'm Nisha and I work with Early Bird, which is a project under the Education and Public Engagement Program of Nature Conservation Foundation. We work towards creating and distributing creative educational content to introduce people to birds. My colleagues, Garima, Avishika, and Ganeshwar are also present in this meeting. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Prachi Mehta from the Wildlife Research and Conservation Society. Thanks a lot, Prachi, for joining us.
Thank you.
So, owls. Owls are extremely fascinating birds. They're spooky, they're quirky. They look very mysterious. Like for those of you who've seen an owl, you'll notice that they stare right back at you. But some of them are also pretty cute. And besides being master hunters, they are featured widely in folktales and stories across cultures. So to give all of you a peek into the world of owls, we have a fun session lined up for you. We'll start with a short quiz, followed by a very interesting talk by Dr. Prachi Mehta. And then we'll have an owl sketching activity towards the end with Abhishek. And during the session, if you guys have any comments, please type them in the chat box. We have muted all the participants to avoid any chaos. And towards the end of the session, we'll open the floor to questions. So without further ado, let's begin with the first part of our session, which is an owl quiz. So for those of you who've already attended some of our sessions before, they would already know how to play this. So what we'll do is I'll read out a statement and you have to guess whether it's fact or fiction. Fact meaning that it's true and fiction meaning that it's false. And if you think it's fact, click on the green yes button that is under the participants list. And if you think it's fiction, click on the red no button under the participants list. And I hope you guys have located them. So I'll begin with the first statement. Fact or fiction? Owls can see during the daytime. Fact or fiction? So we have some 50 people saying yes and some 15 people saying no, that owls cannot see during the daytime. And I won't reveal the answers just yet because I'm hoping that you will find all the answers in Prachi's talk. So, wow, 53 people think it's a fact and 19 people think it's fiction. Okay. So I'm going to move on to the next question. Fact or fiction? All owls hunt at night. Oh, wow, we're running at a 50%, 50-50 tie here. So some 40 people think it's a fact and 34, 35 people think it's fiction. Okay. The third statement, just a sec. Fact or fiction, owls have telescopic vision. Owls have telescopic vision, meaning that they can zoom in and zoom out while looking at objects. Okay, 46 people think yes and 25 people think no. Okay. Next statement. Owls can rotate their necks completely. They can do like a 360 turn with their necks, 360 degrees turn with their necks. Okay, 30 people think yes, and 40 people think no. Okay, the next statement. Some owls have very large ears. Again, 50-50. Oh, this is going to be interesting. Right. 39 people think that it's a fact, and 34 people think it's fiction. Okay. Next statement. Owls have excellent sense of hearing. Okay, 60 people think it's a fact, and 9 people think no, it's fiction. Okay, and now I'm going to share the last statement. A group of owls or a flock of owls is called a gaggle. Fact or fiction? Okay, so 14 to 16 people think that it's a fact, and 48 people think it's fiction. All right, so that's all the questions we have for this quiz. Like I said, I won't reveal the answers because we're hoping that you'll find them out in Prachi's talk. Also, towards the end, we have a bonus question round. So please stay tuned, and we hope you will all participate in that. And now, without further ado, I'm going to pass the virtual quote-unquote mic to Prachi. Hi, Prachi.
Hi, everyone.
Yeah, so I'll introduce Prachi. Dr. Prachi is a wildlife biologist and is associated with the Wildlife Research and Conservation Society in Pune. For over 10 years, Prachi and her team have been working on the ecology of the forest owlet and other coexisting owls in central India. And in this talk, she provides an overview of what makes owls super successful avian predators. Over to you, Prachi. I'll stop sharing my screen. Yeah.
Thank you, thank you, Misha, Garima, Abhishika, and good morning to all of you for being here on a Sunday morning, a lazy Sunday morning on the lockdown days. And I just hope that let's talk about owls and make it a little more perky today. So I thank Early Bird for giving me this opportunity and to talk to all of you today. So, well, I find that early bird and, you know, owl, which is not an early bird, so it's quite a paradox. And it's a lazy bird, I feel. And owls are actually full of paradoxes, is what my, when I started studying, I was really fascinated. And as I started more with the study, I realized that, well, there are so many question marks, you know. So that I'll come to it a little later. As we progress on the our talk. So starting with the world of owls, now just start with the names. Now you have a snowy owl and you have a desert owl. You have a long-eared owl, you have a short-eared owl. You have a dark, the black and white owl, you have a gray, great gray owl. So there are names are, you know, also says that, you know, owls have a wide variety of even names and the species and the appearances. So yeah, but there's a huge variety of owls. And look at the distribution of owls. So there are 7 continents. And as you can see, there are in North America, South America, Europe, Asia, Africa, and Australia, owls are there, except in Antarctica. Now, if you can think why they're not there, you can just type in your answer, why owls are not there in Antarctica. Coming to the owls of the world, there are 225 species of the owls, of which there are again two main families. One is called the true owl. Now, true owls are the ones, there are about 208 species of true owls, and those are the other big owls which has ear tufts, and the heart, the shape, the face of the, can you hear me? Am I audible clearly?
Prachi, there's a request to be louder. I think some people find it faint.
Okay. Now, is it okay? Now, can you hear me?
Yes. It's fine actually, but a little low volume for some.
Okay. So, and there are Kaito owls, which are 17 species, which have typically heart-shaped face and no ear tufts. So these are the, there are 17 species in Kaito owls. In the world, the smallest owl is the elf owl, which is, as you can see, it just comes in your hand. It's very handy. It's just about 20 to 14 centimeters. It's found in Arizona. And the great gray owl is the biggest of all, about 84 centimeter. And the weight is about 1.1 kg. It's found in North America. Now we come to owls of India. There are 34 species, which is amounting to 15% of the world's owl species, of which we have Kaito owls, which are four species, which I said the heart-shaped ones, and the true owls, the rest of them, which are 30 species. You can see some of these pictures at the bottom of the screen. Can you think what is common among all the four of these owls? If you know, you can just type in your answers. And I've just given the names. It's long-eared owl, the short-eared owl, the Paliscops, and the Eurasianscops. And these are all the migrant owl species which come to India. So in India, the smallest owlet is on the top. And if you can guess the name, you can start typing. That is the collared pygmy owlet, which is around 15 centimeter and 60 grams. It's very cute and very compact. And it's found in Northeast India and Himalayas, especially Corbett and these areas, you can see that even in Northeast. And the lower one is the Eurasian eagle owl, also actually is the biggest one. But Eurasian eagle owl is normally found in the Himalayan ranges. In the peninsula, we have the Indian eagle owl, which is the biggest owl in India. Which is about 66 centimeter and the weight is about 1.2 kgs. And yeah. So now we'll take you to a little small journey of how a night in the forest sounds. So just relax, put back your head and imagine that you are in a starry night in the evening and what you hear. So if you can guess which owl is this, you can start typing. And I'll tell you, this is the spotted owl. And which is this owl? Any idea? As the night progresses, this is what you hear.
Prachi, we couldn't hear the call.
Body is not visible. It's not audible.
Not audible? Okay. Just move the panel. Can you hear now?
No, maybe you can stop share and share again by enabling your computer audio.
Can you hear now? Playing the call?
No, Prachi. You'll have to stop share and
okay.
Share the screen again. and select enable computer audio.
All right, okay.
Yes, now we can hear it.
Yeah, you can hear? All right. Sorry about that snag. So, anyone with can guess what this owl would be? So, this is the Indian eagle owl. Okay, we go to the next one. You guessed it right. This is the barn owl, the cute looking Taito owl, which I was telling you, the heart shaped face. You go to the next one. Okay, so this question mark, the call, like what? Any idea? Yeah. So you guessed it. This is the Indian scops owl. This blood curdling call. I'm sure you some of you have heard it. Any idea? So this one is of the mottled wood owl. It looks quite innocent, as you can see, but the calls are quite scary, especially in the evening at night in the forest. It can sound quite intimidating to many people. And this is one of the banshees, you know, what people have thought named the owl, a woman wailing, you know. So that, yeah. Now the next call is okay. So this call is of the Oriental owl. Shrill whistle. What was this call? So I'll play it once more. So this is the brown fish owl, which lives in, you know, riverine areas in the forest. Now this is normally the night melody, what you hear of the owls, you know, at the when you hear throughout the night, you will hear the owl's call in the forest, and the day breaks. In the morning, the first one to call. So, any idea what was this? Yeah, so this is our beautiful jungle owl. It's put everywhere. A very cute looking owl. Okay, so this is the very interesting call of a very interesting species, and I will call it a very enigmatic species. The term forest owl, which is endemic and endangered, and it is found only in India. And this bird has made history and has several stories attached to it. This is one of the species where we are working on for a long time, and it is throwing up surprises every time we come to know a lot more things about it. This species was actually first reported in India in 1882, and then after that, for till 1884, there were some more records, and after that, for 113 years, till 1997, it was thought to be extinct. Was thought to be extinct because people didn't have authentic record of the species, and that time all the scientists and the bird watchers, they thought that forest owl is extinct from India. However, in 1997 it was rediscovered by two American scientists in Maharashtra, and then since then a lot of people have been working on the species, and some research is also going on. So more about that in some other time. So that now we have vented ourselves with some of the few owls of Central India. We go to the next level. That I feel, as I was telling you earlier, that owls have certain congenital defects. First of all, they have asymmetrical ears. They are far-sighted. They have no near vision. So they have hypermetropia, as we call it, that they can only see far but not near distance. They have monochromatic vision. They have more of rods, less of cones. So that is the reason they cannot see colored images. They only see in black and white. It's quite a defect, I think. It's quite old-fashioned to see things just in black and white. They have very small beak. If you see their face and their beak, and if you see other raptors, you know, they have very powerful, magnificent beaks. Owls have very quaint beaks. Also, compared to their body, they have very small talons. If you see, say, crested serpent eagle or some other raptors, they have bigger talons, longer legs. Owls have shorter legs and smaller talons. They have weak stomach. I'll talk about this later as we progress. So their digestive system is not that great. They are not fast flyers, unlike all the other raptors, like even, you know, your falcons and shikras. Owls are lazy flyers. They will just they'll keep flying around. They'll smoothly glide, but they will not fly very fast. And the worst thing is they sleep during the day. Very lazy. So this is one of the reason I think that they have certain defects. You know, the model is defective. Now I'm going to play one video. Please excuse me for the quality of the video, because Zoom is really not meant to telecast videos. So we've been trying this. The video will show you. So I repeat that I'm sorry about the quality, but that original video is very good. Now, what I wanted to show you here was that when you saw the owl flying, there was no noise. It has very silent flight. And if you remember that even the pigeons, if they fly, they make a lot of fluttering sound. You know, even the hornbills or even other birds, when they fly, there is flapping of wings. Now, why does this happen? Now, on the left side, you can see the owl flight feathers. They have comb-like serrations here. So, when the air wave passes through it, the serrations break and they settle down and the air passes through it very smoothly. And that is why there is no sound. Now on the right side, you can see a pigeon flight feather. Now they have very intricate barbules. So when the air passes through, there's a turbulence which is caused. And that causes a wave motion and the sound. Now, owls have achieved this. Why? Because they hunt at night. They don't want to reveal themselves because if the flight, the sound of their flapping of wings come, no prey is going to be there. And they will definitely move away from there. And that is the reason owls are super smart. They have evolved in such a way that they can fly very silently. So this is one of their adaptations. Now, I was talking about owl ears. Owls have asymmetrical ears. You know, as we have, you know, at the same position on the face, owls have one which is slightly raised and other which is slightly below. I think it's quite funny. But owls have deliberately got this feature because they need to hear the minutest of the sound in the night because they're hunting in the night. And that is why all the sound which they need to capture have to be captured very precisely so that they can just pounce on the prey, which is moving very silently in the field. Mostly these are rodents and, you know, insects and reptiles. Sorry. So this asymmetrical ears make them, the sound waves come at different times, hit the ears at a different time. So they are able to judge the depth of the object and the distance of the object. Sorry, not the depth, I'm sorry. I mean the distance of the object. And very often you must have seen owls bobbing their heads like this. They are just not being cute. They are trying to do this. They are trying to estimate the distance of the object by moving their head so that, you know, if the object is very far and which the sound hits which ear fastest. So they would know by method of triangulation, they pinpoint the object. So that is one of the smart ways of getting the objects, the distance of the objects. Another thing is that they have this facial disc. As you can see in the center, there is this gray owl, which has a very lot of concentric rings on its face. Now this acts like a satellite dish, you know? So it accumulates all the sound and funnels it into the ears. So it concentrates the sound. So in our jungle owlet also, you can see that they have this kind of rings. Even some other owls, which you can think, which has rings on their heads, you can start typing there. You must have seen a lot of owls with ear tufts. You know, we say that, oh, these are ear tufts. But you know what? These are not ear tufts. I mean, they are just for a show. And they are actually, they indicate their mood swings of the owls. They don't hear. They are just feathers there. And if the owl wants to merge with the surrounding, that really helps them. As you can see on the eagle owl on the left side, you know, if it's there on the tree, it's very difficult to make out. If the branch is there, it really helps them to camouflage. And the brown fish owl on the right side, you can see it's really camouflaged because of the ears also. And another thing is when the owls is aggressive, they want to look bigger and dominating, and that's when they really raise up their ears, they puff up their size, and they look big and very intimidating to the prey or the opposite person. And that makes it difficult for the other person to, you know, go anywhere close to the owls. And when they are in a submissive pose, the ear tufts go down, they flatten down, which also suggests that, you know, they are calm, they are not in the threatening position. So ear tufts actually are more of mood swings and not for hearing at all. Owls have immobile eyes. Now, as you know that, you know, we also have front-facing eyes. Owls also have front-facing eyes, right? But we can move our eyes like this, right? Owls cannot do that. They cannot move their eyes. They are actually not eyeballs. Owl eyes are like tubes which are fitted in that ring of bones. And as compared to, if you compare it with the another raptor, which is the crested serpent eagle, If you can see, the eyes are to the side of the face. Yeah, so they can have lateral vision very well. But so our vision, it has about 110 degree field of vision, and it has 64% binocular vision. Binocular vision is when you can see from both the eyes one object together. And other birds, which has 300 degrees of field of vision, because they can see from both the eyes on different sides, but the binocular vision is very limited to 10%. So though owls have immobile eyes, they have used it to their advantage. And here I'm going to play another video. Please wait. So as you saw, the owls cannot move their eyes, so they have to move their entire head to look up, look down, look sideways. And what happens when they do so much of movement, they have a very special blood circulation which goes to their head and it reaches their brain. So they have adapted in such a way that just because they have to move their head, the blood supply also gushes in and keeps them intact and alert. So this video just showed that, you know, how owls can move their head to 270 degrees. Yeah. Another thing about owl eyes. Now you can see this, owls have red colored eyes. Actually, they're not red colored eyes. This is actually reflection, and this is a layer called tapetum lucidum, which is just behind the retina, and that it just reflects the light which is coming in, and it reflects it back. So that helps the owl to see very clearly in the dark. Now, most nocturnal animals, even mammals and birds, have this tapetum lucidum. Do we have tapetum lucidum? What do you think? Let me know. You can write whether we have tapetum lucidum or not. And also, owls, they have, as I said earlier, that they have far-sighted vision. So they have a lot more rods in their eyes. And there are two types of cells, rods and cones. So owls are rich in rods and very poor in cones. So that's how they can see much better in the dim light, at least 100 times better than humans can. But they cannot see color. So if they have a black mice or a white mice, they would not be able to differentiate. As for them, it's just food which is moving around. Now, another very interesting thing about the owls, they have different eye colors. I'm sure all of you who have seen owls must have noticed that some are dark colored, some are yellow, some are orange. What does this mean? What is the reason? Now, I have been reading up and I've been observing also, and there's some literature also, published literature, but it's very interesting to read that the night owls, which are nocturnal owls, they have dark brown eyes. The day owls, the diurnal owls, the ones which are active during the daytime, they have bright yellow eyes. The ones which are crepuscular owls, in the sense when they are active during the dusk and dawn, low light periods, they have they are called the twilight owls. They have orange colored eyes. Now this, and there are certain gray areas which have, you know, which we have not been able to establish, like certain owls which are also nocturnal, but they have yellow eyes. So there are a few exceptions, but this theory needs to be investigated. But for about 80% of the owls, they seem to fit. So I just thought, okay, I'll just bring it here to say that, you know, your eye color says it all, like what owls you could be. So you can just think of some owls and think of their daytime and maybe their activity time, and maybe you can relate it to it. So for instance, snowy owl. Now snowy owl, what color eyes they have? Anyone? You can start writing there. So snowy owls, they... they live in tundras. They have their in this and they hunt during the daytime. So what colored eyes would they be having? Yeah, so they'll be having yellow colored eyes. So you can check it later if snowy owls have yellow colored eyes. So you can just keep checking this if it really, the theory fits. Another interesting feature of the owl is the talons. I was telling you that, you know, owls have short and stumpy talons. Though they are very powerful hunters, they have short talons. And you can see on the left, there's a barn owl talon. And for a comparison, I have shown the serpent eagle, which is another raptor, right? Their talon. And the owl talons, they are zygotactiles. Zygotactile in the sense that they are flexible. So they can sit with the two of their talons in the front, two of the talons in the front like this, and two of the behind. So here they can move, they can clasp, they can put a grip, they can grip a prey, or they can sit on a branch. Whereas you can see on the eagles, they have three of them like this. So owls have a particular way of sitting, perching, and because they have a support, because one of their thumb, which moves, which is, you know, flexible, they can even sit and sleep. They don't fall off. Another feature of the owl is they have cryptic colors. Now here you can see on the left side is the brownfish owl, and see how well it merges with the tree trunk. And on the right side is a juvenile of an eagle owl. I could not even see this bird for quite some time. It was so well camouflaged. And just because of the ears, I could see that there's something there, and see the body color and see the trunk color. So owls have this ability to camouflage themselves because they are out during the day, roosting or resting, sleeping, or some of them hunting, and they need to hide themselves to protect themselves from other predators. Another feature of the owls is some owls, like this is the pygmy owl. This is the northern pygmy owl. And in our country, the counterpart is, if you know the answer, you can just type in. The counterpart I already told you about, the pygmy owl, which is found in Himalayas, the smallest owl. Now that and this owl, both of them have false eyes. So what you see at the back of the head is just the feathers. It's not the eye. It looks like the eye, but it's not the eye. Now, why do these diurnal owls have to have this? Because the diurnal owls, those who are active during the daytime, they get mobbed by other birds, you know, like mynas, drongos, parakeets. So for their safety, what they do is they have this false eyes, so which sort of tells the predator, the other birds, look, I'm watching you. Don't come close to me. I had a picture of the collared pygmy owl, but I couldn't find it. But it has similar marking, and it really looks as if it's just looking at you from the back of its head. Now I'll come to another video, which is about gular fluttering. Now gular is a throat patch in a bird. That is, a throat is called the gular patch, and fluttering means waving. Now what happens, owls at times, and this gular fluttering is seen in many other birds also, especially during the summertime. If you just look out now also, you'll see many birds with open beak. You know, many of them sit during the summer because that is how they exchange air, and the air passes through the buccal cavity and it cools it down with the moisture. So what owls do, that they'll open the beak slightly, let the air come in, and the hot air is exchanged out and the cooler air is taken. Now please watch this video. You can see the fluttering of the white patch on the throat. I'll just play it once more. Yeah, I'm sorry about the video quality. So the And it is moving. It is moving up and down. So, the original video is very beautiful, actually. But I'm sorry, I can't share it. I've seen it. Now, very interesting thing about owls, they don't have the guts to stomach it. So, you know, all the birds have a special feature called, in their digestive system, a special organ called crop, C-R-O-P, where it stores the food for later digestion. Now, owls do not have the crop. Why? If you can think of it, you can write your answer, or later I can tell you why they don't have the crop. Right, now they don't have the crop, so the food which they swallow, and about that also I'll tell you, they swallow it very quickly. In one gulp, they swallow the food, it goes straight in the stomach, and I said that the owl's stomach has weak, they have weak stomachs, you know, weak pH. So a lot of undigestible items like, you know, feathers, the claws, what they eat, the dentition, skeleton, the feathers and the insect skeleton, they all remain undigested. They do not get digested because they have a weak stomach. All this gets rolled up into a ball of in a kind of a shape of the stomach, and it comes out from the stomach to its throat, and it ejects the pellet. It is called a pellet. The pellet is ejected out, or it's called regurgitated. And when the owl does that, so it has a particular cycle. It will regurgitate the pellet, and then it will be ready to eat another meal. So just when the owl has regurgitated, you should know that now it's going to make a kill. So I'm going to show you another video about regurgitation of pellet. So that was the pellet which came out. So owls, since they are hunting during the daytime, a lot of other birds chase them, like crows, tree pies. So they gulp their food in one go quickly, or sometimes they go and hide it. They catch the prey. So here you can see the jungle owlet with a hanging tail of reptile, calotus it had eaten. So it has just gulped it. And this is another video of an owl feeding on a large insect, a hopper. Please watch. Yeah, so as you, the video probably didn't show very well, but here it sort of dismembers the grasshopper, and then it gulps it inside. Yeah, so we move to the next. This is what comes out. This is what the pellets look like. So you can see the size and the shape, and there are remains. You know, if you see closely, you will see some dentition, some shells, then some skulls and feathers and insect skeletons also you can see here. And then what we do is we collect the pellets and we analyze it to understand what it has eaten. So we tease it apart and remove all the prey remains. So on the left, as on the top, you can see this is how the pellet dissection takes place. And below you see like what we have cleaned out. And there is one big, collection of incisors. There are incisors, there's dentition, there's skull, and all mammal bones, hip bones, of all the whatever it has eaten. So this is a kind of a jigsaw puzzle. And we sit and we look at what all it has eaten, how much it has eaten, And then that is how we come to a analysis of diet of the owl. So this is how the owls, the skeletons in owl pellets look. So you can see this big mandibles of a bandicoot. This is. And yes, there are some very colorful evidences also. This is like jewels in owl pellet. This is my favorite picture. I really like it because these are all remains of the jewel beetle. And you can see the leg and the carapace and the head and the body parts. And it's a very, this is what the owl has eaten. So coming back to my first statement that they have the defective, actually owls are very clever. So why they have this asymmetrical ears? As I explained, that because they can have better depth of object when the sound is coming, and on the night they will pounce and they never fail. Once they estimate the distance of how far is the prey, even 100 meter, or I think great gray owls go for kilometer and they can go and pounce on the prey. Again, their farsightedness is again for prey detection, but they can see in dark. Their small beak is actually a blessing for them. If they had a large beak, they would not be able to see because they have a round face. So for unobstructed view, the small beaks really help them for hunting. They have small talons, so it gives them very powerful grip on the prey. As I said, the weak stomach, so they don't need to digest food further. I know they can immediately... The other undigestible matter, like other raptors, somebody just asked, other raptors, they actually pluck the prey much more than the owls. If you notice kestrels or any other birds of prey, they will pluck birds, the prey, and they'll eat it. This owl just eats it as a whole. And then whatever is undigested, they remove it and they're ready for the next meal. So they require a far more, they have to be in prey-rich areas. They require, a barn owl requires about 1,000 rats in a year. So that is why barn owls are very good. And in fact, all owls are very good because they really control the rodent population. They are not fast flyers, which is again to their advantage because they surprise the prey and they go slowly and they pounce. And because of the powerful talons, they can just grip the prey. Well, and they sleep during the day. Well, they are lazy, but they are very smart because they avoid predation by other raptors and other birds of prey. And during the day, they just stay put in their cavities. And those who are out, of course, have to face the music, like some diurnal owls. But the night owls, they normally do not have many more natural prey, the adults, not the young ones. So to summarize, I said, many of you must be knowing the beautiful owl rhyme. I won't go for the first line. I'm sure you all know it. The wise old owl sat on an oak. The more he saw, the less he spoke. The less he spoke, the more he heard. That's why we all ought to be like the wise old bird. And that is why the owl is a wise old bird. And I think that, if you're interested, especially for the, I'm sure many of you must have seen this movie. It was, I think, released in 2015 or 16, The Legend of the Guardians. And once you see this movie, you'll be able to relate us so much more, what we discussed today about the true owls and the why owls are they cock their heads and how the young ones fly and many other adaptations. It's a very good movie if you can watch. And here I'd like to stop and thank you very much, Early Bird, and the audience for being there and listening to me. I also would like to thank Garima, Misha, and Abhishekha for wonderful coordination for this talk. Thank you very much. It was great working with you guys. I thank all my team members who have been with me throughout on this OWL project. So Jayant Kulkarni, then Shubham Giri, Sumit Bobre, Nikhil Jambale, Akshay Anand, they all have contributed. Mahashweta Patnaik, some of those pictures and videos are from my research team and they all have done very good work. We have excellent team in the field and I must mention their name is Ashok, Ram, Jitendra, Prem. They've all been very helpful. And I would like to thank RRCF our supporting agency, Raptor Research and Conservation Foundation, and Maharashtra Forest Department and Madhya Pradesh Forest Department for giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much. And any questions, then we can, next I hand it over to Abhisheka. We can take.
Hey guys, if you have any questions, please wait till the end of the talk. We have another short owl sketching activity by Abhisheka. I hope you have your pencils and papers ready. And please hold on to your questions for the end of the session. And thank you so much, Prachi. That was amazing. Abhisheka, over to you.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'll just share the screen and start.
Hi everyone, just please don't leave. We have a prize giveaway also at the end. Please hold on till the end of the session.
Are you able to see the screen?
Yes.
The full screen?
No, it's not in full screen mode. Yes, now it is.
Okay. Welcome back to the sketching session. Those of you who had attended the earlier early bird sketching sessions, you might have, today's session too will follow the same steps to draw a bird. It's a good revision. It's always nice to go back and draw more birds. For those of you who are sketching the bird for a first time, I'll take you through a step-by-step method, easy way of drawing a bird. And today, after Prachi's brilliant talk, I think it's wonderful to learn to draw an owl. So I hope you all have your paper and pencil ready. We can we'll start drawing an owlet. Let me just check the messages. Sorry, I can't see the chat box. So I'm assuming people are ready with your pencil and paper.
Yes, you can continue, Abhisheka.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so we do know that birds don't, a particular bird, a species of bird, it looks very different when it's flying or sitting or bathing. Or for example, this owlet could, stretch its neck and look different. And while it keeps holds its head close to the body, it will look different. So observing the posture of a bird is very important when you want to sketch a bird. For example, like here with this flower picker, so the bird is almost bent to an horizontal position. So here I've drawn a horizontal line running through the body, from the head through the body. And then if we look at another example of the red-whiskered bulbul here, it's sitting up straight. So I've drawn a line that runs, vertical from the head to the towards the tail. So it's important for us to begin drawing this line to show the posture of the bird, which will make it easier for us to, start drawing a bird. Otherwise, if you just start sketching from, say, the beak of the bird and start, by the time you end the drawing, when you come towards the tail, the bird might not even look like the actual bird that you wanted to draw. So we'll begin by drawing a faint line like this on the paper. So yeah, just draw a faint line like this. And then to show the body mass, draw an oval. Now, these are a few basic shapes that we'll use to build the form of a bird. So you can draw them very lightly. You don't have to draw these shapes too dark. When we start adding the details, you can make it dark. And then the next part is the head. So here, draw a circle for the head, and the circle is overlapping with the oval because the bird is holding its head closer to the body. And also make sure when you draw birds, you kind of make sure the head is in the right proportion to the body. Okay, next, you can mark a V shape here to show the beak. And then mark the width and length of the tail. Okay. Now next. Just draw these angles. You can join the head to the body here, near the neck, and then the tail to the body can be joined. So just bring all the basic forms together here. Okay. I'll move on from here. Now you can also show the wing. So here the right wing is slightly seen also. The angle in which the bird is sitting, we can see a bit of the right wing. So you can show that. And also just mark the left wing. Hope you've all completed till here. Okay, next. Now we'll start adding the details. So first start with the eye and make sure you draw the pupil as well as the iris. And then you can also add show a bit of the talon. So in this bird, the way it's sitting, you can't see the entire feet. So just showing some bit of the talon here. And as Prachi mentioned, in owls, the eyes are faced in the front of the face, and very much like humans, unlike many birds where the eyes are placed at the side of the head. Next, we'll start getting into more details of the face. We'll begin with the face. Now you can start shading. Leave a bit of like a white spot for the highlight, because the highlight is what brings alive any animal when you're drawing. And then fill in more details. Already you can see that the owl is staring at you. Okay, now we'll add some bit of feathers. The facial disc is the speciality of owls. So we'll start adding feathers. And then you could also add some bit of feathers around the beak. So start building that disc shape of the face when you're adding these feathers. So in owls, you can also see some bristles around the beak, so you can showcase some bit of that in the bill. And do a message when you're done. Till here. Okay. There's a request to go slower. Sure, I'll wait until you all finish till this. Okay. I'll continue because people seem to have completed till this step. Okay, and the next step is try to draw the contour, define the contour of the body. So try to darken the entire outline of the body. And then here I've also added some more details for the some bit of plumage here towards the right wing and towards the neck. And also some bit of plumage where the tail is joining the body. That's also part of the wing that is showing a bit. Someone has messaged saying your drawing is horrible. Don't worry if you're doing it for the first time. I mean, with any drawing, whether humans or animals, it's always practice that matters. So the more you draw, the more you'll get better at it. So don't worry if this drawing doesn't come out well. What is more important is the steps to that you learn to draw a bird. So you can always repeat this after the session. Okay, so I'll repeat, add in some plumage. Yeah, the wing, neck, and some bit of plumage showing here. This is also part of the wing, the right wing. Yeah. Okay, this is what we are drawing is the spotted owlet. I'll type in the name at the end of this session. Okay, I'll move on. Now, I've added some more details to the face. So around the eyes, you can add in more feathers here and then this circular feather here. And here, so you see, you can kind of, you know, go along the shape of the eye. So try to draw more circular feathers here around the eye. So I've added, just build on the face. So you have the eyes first and then another round going around it and then the feathers here. So you can already see the facial disc forming. And I've also added some more details to the talons. So again, remember that as Prachi mentioned, they have four talons, but here I've just only shown two. The other two are hidden behind the branch. So you can also draw the branch here. And then you can also erase the posture line that you had drawn earlier if you want, or keep it if it helps. So draw the talons and the branch. Shall I move on? Hope people have drawn till here. Okay, next. So in spotted owlets, there are some spots on the forehead and the back. of the head. So you can add in those details here on top of the head. So you see this spot, white spot-like designs on the plumage here. So you can just add in some of those details here. Okay, and next. Now let's begin adding some bit of details to the wings. And so here, if you see, I've shown, it's not too detailed, but just a suggestion of some primary feathers, and then you have the secondary feathers, and then there are the wing coverts, and then the scapulars. So just add in some details. I mean, this is not a very detailed, realistic drawing, but so there's some, just a bit of suggestion of these different kinds of feathers that you can see on the wing of the of a bird. Hope you've completed till here, and do message if you want me to wait. Sure. Yeah, I think some of you want me to wait. I'll do that. Yeah, sure. Yes, I'm waiting. So again, I'll repeat, just add in some bit of these lines to show the primary feathers and the secondary feathers and the coverts as well as the scapular. Okay, Lakshmikant says, Owlet became angry. It's okay. I think when spotted owlets look at us, they stare at us, they do give an angry look, though sometimes they're too funny and cute. Somebody saying you're bad at sketching. Don't worry. I think, I mean, what is important is not how great the sketch is. The process is what is important. The joy of drawing a bird is what is important. So don't worry about how bad or good your sketch looks. Also, if this is your first time, you will struggle a bit. So it's okay. You can always practice and learn better. Okay, so can I move on? I don't see any answers. Okay, I think I'll continue. Okay, now the spotted owlet also has a lot of spots on its body feathers also, just like the feathers you saw on the head. So draw some spots. Again, here these spots are just a suggestion, because we're not going to do a very detailed drawing. But you can later, you know, take a look at the photographs of spotted owlets and see these patterns in detail. So just add some spots to show that, you know, they have these kind of patterns. And also some bit of some texture on the underside of the right wing too. Just some markings, very light markings. So now you can see why this owlet is called a spotted owlet. It's got a lot of spots. Also, the nice thing is when you, one of the nice things about drawing birds than just watching them is you start going into seeing the details. If you actually look at a photograph and start sketching this bird, you'll see how each of these spots are placed on the feathers and those kind of details, which we kind of miss out when we are just, you know, looking at them with a naked eye or a binocular for a few seconds. Okay, someone wants to know if I sketch birds or I sketch people too. There was a time when I used to sketch people, but not anymore. Now I sketch a lot of nature, but I used to sketch people, yeah. Okay, we'll move on to the next step. Okay, now the owlet also has a lot of markings on its you know, breast and belly area. You can add some bit of those markings, and it becomes more whitish towards the abdomen. So just add in all these markings. And yes, please make sure, I hope this session will inspire you to look at owls or any other birds in detail henceforth. Okay, now you can also add some bit of markings on the underside of the tail too. So just like the wing feathers, even the tail feathers, they're kind of placed one over the other. Okay, before I move on to the next step, which is the last, share your sketches with us. We'll share the email ID later after this session, towards the end of the session. And also, you can also share it on our Facebook page. So we would like to see your sketches. Have you all completed till here? Or should I wait?
I think you can go ahead, Abhi.
Okay. So, okay, this is it. Now what you can do after the session, if you feel like coloring your bird, you can go ahead and do that. You, here I've just used some charcoal powder, but you could try out with whatever medium that you're comfortable with. Charcoal or watercolors or color pencils or just pencil shading, whatever you feel like it. You can refer photographs for now and color this work. And for those of you who would like to know more about bird sketching, there are actually lots of video tutorials available online these days. We are a very lucky generation. Unlike when I started off, we just didn't have these internet options or videos to learn from. So please go and check out some of these really good artists like John Laws or David Sibley, and they all put out free online videos and where you can learn more detail as to how to draw a bird. So yeah, I do hope that you spend some time every day if possible to watch birds, because it's very important to watch birds and their behavior to start sketching, realistic works of to make realistic artworks of birds. So not just referring to photograph, but it's important that you spend time watching birds also. So I hope after this session, you'll start doing that. Now let's come to the answers for the quiz. So that Misha asked in the beginning, I hope that most of you have found the answers through Prachi's talk. But even then, I'll just reveal the answers. Here they are. And if any of you have got all the answers right, do give yourself a pat on your back and congratulations for getting the answers right. And yeah, so this is a sketch of another owl feather. So if you find fallen bird feathers, just pick it up and start studying them. Okay, now we come to our final quiz. So before I show you the questions, the condition is that please do not post your answers right away on the chat box or Facebook. Please send us the answers. I'll also show you the email ID to which you need to mail us the answers. So here we go. The two questions that you need to send us the answers are here. Which species of owl has the name of two gods in its scientific name? And the second question is, in which Indian state do farmers put up poles to attract owls to their agricultural fields? Now send us the answers for these questions before 3 p.m. today, and then you'll be getting some beautifully illustrated bookmarks from Early Bird.
You can take a screenshot of this. These questions so that you can also refer to them later, I mean before 3 p.m.
Yeah, so now that we have come to the end of the session, if you have any questions, please post them in the chat box. And
okay, I have temporarily disabled the chat box. I'm going to enable it again.
Okay.
There were a few questions during the course of the session. So maybe we can address those. Prachi, are you online?
Yes, I'm online, Arima.
Yeah.
So there are so many questions. First of all, Abhishekha, it's a beautiful owl, really. You're an amazing artist. It's great to see this. And I think all of them enjoyed it, you know, doing this activity. So
Thank you.
Right, so there are many questions. I can just pick a few because, you know, that we are short of time. There's somebody asked a very interesting question saying that why do other raptors do not need to be silent while flying? Well, my answer to that is that other raptors who fly during the daytime, they do, because there's a lot of ambient noise, you know, theirs being silent will not help. But night, because it is silent, the flight of the owl's noise will definitely alert the prey. And that is why they have adapted this to become have a silent flight. Somebody asked, owls blink? Yes, they do. I have several pictures of them. They have three eyelids. One is the upper one, the lower one, and they also have another nictitating membrane, which they pull it when, you know, they want to protect their eyes from dust or water. So they do blink, yes. About the lynx, I'm very sorry about the video that we couldn't really show you the videos, but the lynx, some of them are on the YouTube, one or two, or the rest of them are our own personal videos of our work. So I'll see if I can watermark it and share it. Another question was what is the advantage of having monochrome vision, black and white? So see, owls do not need to have, first of all, to have colored vision, you have to have cone cells. Now, owls have more of rod cells so that they can see in dim light. That is when they actually function and operate. So they want to be efficient predators. They want to detect movement and not color. So I think that is the reason that they do not need to have colored vision. I mean, that is how they have evolved that way. And this is what I just could pick up. Anything else?
Prachi, there was a question on Facebook actually asking about snowy owls and how do they hear during a blizzard.
on the contrary, how do they?
How do they hear during a blizzard if there's a snowstorm?
So I am not sure, but I think owls have, owls can even hear during the night, you know, in monsoons, during the rainy season. So I guess the same logic would apply, that if a blizzard is there, they would definitely hear. And but they don't hunt in blizzard. Owls, they will stay put. Yeah, so see, they may not need to detect the, this is what my guess is.
Right, thanks. There was another question about, actually several people wanted to know the status of forest owlet.
Forest owlet,
yes. Right.
So the forest owlet now is there in a few locations in central India and some of them in Western Ghats, up till Gujarat and Maharashtra so far. So, you know, in Maharashtra, so there are about 12 confirmed locations from 5 or 6 from Maharashtra, 3 from Madhya Pradesh and 3 from Gujarat. And so it's an endangered species. It was earlier thought to be critically endangered, but IUCN has revised it, thinking that, you know, there are maybe poor populations there in Gujarat. We don't have the number of birds as so far, so I cannot comment on that. But still, they are in isolated populations in certain areas in reserved forest where it is not even protected. So they are there in small numbers there.
Okay, thank you so much. And I think the questions will keep coming, but we are running short of time. There's one more question from Richa. Had come across a barn owl chick in my apartment. It let me stand right next to it, but when I spoke to it softly, it got startled and flew off. Why did my voice spook it and not my presence?
Yeah. No, so you held it to you, is it? Or it just... No, so they are not used to human presence. You know, they will be very alert and they would definitely try to avoid it. So any you know, signal of any other, you know, some alien apart from their others, then their mothers, they will not be very comfortable. They are not pet owls.
So
yeah, Lara, you are asking something, you're raising your hand.
So there's a question, how about protecting owls? They are killed during Diwali. Do you want to comment on that?
Oh yes, actually that is a very big threat, and that has been happening throughout for so many years. And though we have all the laws in place, but it does happen and they're serious, it has to be seriously addressed. And for that, we really need to work with the local communities and look at the links, you know, the market link and how it is progressing, in which areas this is coming out from, you know. We know of the areas, there are some very good reports from WWF about, so you can read about that. It was, I think, 2010 it was published. And unfortunately, I think the same way the trade is continuing, and we need more actions on that. I'm also very concerned on that.
Okay, I think we'll have to close this session now. Prachi, thank you so much for an absolutely scintillating talk with all those videos and photos. I think everyone who attended this session would definitely be big fan of owls now.
I hope so, yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And everyone who joined, thank you so much for joining us. Please follow our social media pages, which we have posted in the chat box. We will be announcing our future sessions there, and we'll be uploading this one on YouTube as well. Thank you so much. Stay safe and see you next time.
Thank you very much, everyone.